Charles, thank you very much for being with us. You've been CEO of Koch Industries for 50 years. And during most of those years, a conference stage like this would be the last place anybody would find you.
With all these wonderful people? I'm going to start doing this every day.
I'm told you barely even went out for lunch. But in the last year, you've started doing more publicly. Tell us why you are going from the very private Charles Koch to the new public Charles Koch.
Well, we grew to a size and gained enough notoriety that we had to, because there were all these misconceptions about who we were, what we did, and why we did it, that we needed to. And I said, okay, I will do it as promotion of my book last year. And I'm sure all of you have multiple copies and given hundreds to your friends. That's why the sales are so good. But once I agreed to that, and then I had a great interview with Megyn Kelly, and then that kind of said, well, maybe I'll do more if they're all as good as that one.
But you talked about the notoriety. I mean, in political lingo, you were being defined by your opponents.
Isn't that how we're all defined, more or less?
Yeah, so what was wrong with that picture?
I think it'd be an easier answer to answer what was right with it. No, I've said, people say, well, when you read about you in the media, what portion should I believe? That's the question I get. And I'd say, about 10%.
It's that bad?
That bad. But, I mean, it's depends on the publication, of course. Some would be zero and some would be the majority.
Presumably Fortune would be on the high side, but we won't go there right now.
Yeah, we would hope so.
So I want to come back to the notoriety and the politics in a little bit, but I want you to talk first about how you run this company, because I think it's very unique. Could you have built, and I should tell the audience if you don't know, Koch Industries, when Charles took over, had about $200 million in revenue. Today it has $115 billion in revenue. It is kind of consistently doubled. I mean, you don't report, so I can't vouch for these numbers, but so we're told anyway. It doubles every 6 years or so. Could you have done that if you were a public company?
Well, maybe somebody could. I couldn't have, because I would have been fired, because I had these crazy ideas drawing from my interest in the philosophy of science, the scientific method, and in my studies of how people can best live and work together. And so I would say, okay, I'd like to take those ideas on what makes societies more innovative and progressive and productive than others, and let's find out how to use those inside an organization.
Why would that have gotten you fired?
Well, because most of the time it didn't work, because an organization's different than a society, so you just can't, like, take private property. Okay, every employee owns their property and exchanges. Well, and you have internal markets. Well, that gets too complex. That doesn't work. So you have to think through, or we did, had to think through, what are the benefits? And then how do we duplicate the benefits? But we've got to use a different mechanism. And so we were, like I believe that most innovation comes from trial and error. And it's not just trial and succeed. The error is there for a purpose. Like I say to our people, okay, if you think you're experimenting and you never have any failures, you're not really experimenting. You're not trying anything new. And so we went through quite a period where we had, what I was doing was hurting the company, because everybody was confused, kept changing things. And then we finally came up with an approach that really started to pay off.
And we don't have a lot of time here, but can you briefly describe the approach and how it works?
Well, as I say, it's based on the philosophy of science, and we learned to boil it down into a framework of five elements. They're called vision, virtue and talents, knowledge processes, decision rights, and incentives. And each one, that was a package of dozens of principles, elements, practices. And we find when all those are working together in an integrated, reinforcing way, you really get performance.
So can you give us like one example of how that works in practice that's dramatically different from the way most public companies work?
Well, I think one way is that we have found, now it may be not be true for any of your companies, but in the experienced people we hire and the companies we acquire, we find that most of them hire first on talent and then they hope that the values are compatible with their culture. We hire first on values, and we have 10 guiding principles that many companies have principles, but we found also in many companies that they're some they stick in the drawer, it's a poster on the wall. These principles are who we are as a company. They guide everything we do, including who we hire. That's one. Another is the division of labor by comparative advantage, and what I mean by that is that rather than, okay, you have a vision, you need certain roles filled, and you try to get the best person for each one. We try to optimize every person's role according to what they're good at and they have a passion for. And this is not easy, as you can tell. This takes a lot of work and intensive care. But we find when we get all that right, the right people in the right roles, with the right vision and the right values, I mean, then we really have great innovations that improve.
So choosing, getting the right people, choosing the team comes first.
That's first.
Now, I've told you, it's my theory that the reason you, after being so incredibly private for 49 years, have started to talk more publicly is because in the competition for talent, you feel like you have to get a positive story out there or people aren't going to want to work for Coke Industries.
No, that's a good part of it, no question. It's usually you have great insight, Alan.
Thank you, yeah. But is it working? I mean, are you getting, so you had this sort of notoriety that was created by the press, in part because of your political activities. I wonder, by the way, did your political activities in that sense hurt Coke Industries?
It's not measurable. We have a lot of boycotts against us, and then we have a lot of people who write and say, boy, we're going to start using all your products. So I don't know what the balance is, but we can't measure it. I would think overall it's positive because...
You never thought we should just shut this down and focus on doing our business?
Shut it down. As I like to say, I'd rather die for something than live for nothing. So there's no alternative for me. This is who I am.
So talk. Since we're on this topic, talk a little bit about what you have spent literally hundreds of millions of dollars, probably more than that. You spent a fair amount of your fortune trying to change the political system.
Well, we've spent a considerable amount, but we've raised a lot more
other money as well. Talk about what you were trying to achieve with that.
Well, we see, or I should say, I see the country headed toward a two-tiered society, a society increasingly based on control, dependency, and cronyism, which is pitting individuals and groups against each other. And my dream would be to move us toward a society that maximizes peace, mutual respect, and well-being for everybody.
Now, in the money you've invested in your business, you've gotten incredible returns. In the money you've invested in politics, how do you feel about the return you've gotten?
Well, most of that is obviously not in politics because it's hard to find politicians that are really working, trying to change the trajectory from what I believe where it's going to where it could go. And so most of it has been on education, community programs, things of that sort.
But you've spent a fair amount in politics. I mean, you're one of the largest givers.
We are?
Yes, you are.
Okay, well, I'll take your word for it.
How do you feel about the progress you've made in the political arena?
Well, not so much in politics, but in policies. We've done some good over the years.
Moving towards less regulation, less subsidy?
Well, let's say productive rather than destructive regulation.
Generally, that means less regulation.
Yeah, because there's a lot of regulation that's very destructive and anti-competition and anti-innovation.
I want to come back to the anti-innovation point, but before we do, since we're on politics, can you talk about what you see in the current presidential election?
Yeah, I see two people that, as of this point, we're not supporting.
But the day may come where you have to make a choice for one of them.
Why do I have to? Are you going to put a gun to my head?
Oh, you're a citizen. Like I can tell. Union? I can tell from talking to you that you're a conscientious citizen who will want to cast a vote in November.
But if I had to vote for cancer or a heart attack, why would I vote for either?
No, and can you tell us which is cancer and which is heart attack?
No. I get confused on that issue.
But what if
I just don't want them both at the same time?
But what about Donald Trump? What's your problem with Donald Trump?
Well, I'm sure he's a fine fellow underneath, but there's just a lot. And when you look at our guiding principles, you see that his guiding principles are in many ways antithetical to him, and a great many of his policies are antithetical. For example, if we're going to put on a 40% tariff, Smoot-Hawley was a 60% increase in tariff, and it caused a reduction in world trade by 70% and led to a worldwide depression. So I think that's a monstrosity.
So not a great way to go.
No.
Now you said...
And there are a number of others, but we don't have time to go through all
of those. No, but you said in one television interview, I think you were asked, well, then would you vote for Hillary Clinton? And you said something like, well, I might.
No, that isn't. That's
what did you say?
This is why I say, well, it's like
I want to go back to being private.
It's like I rode up in the elevator with Charles Barkley at the Barcelona Olympics, and he was being attacked, and I said something. He says, "Yeah, the media never lets the truth get in the way of a good story," and that's it. So they what?
So
and I know you're not in.
No,
that
I'm here. I'm here to let you tell the true story.
Okay, so the deal is what I said is it. Would you ever support her? I said, it's possible if she totally changed everything she stood for. And they spun that around to I might support Hillary. Okay, I got to be more careful what I say. And the best is not say it. You can see why all those years I didn't give interviews.
All right, let's talk about innovation because, I'm going to get to you. I promise I'll leave time for questions. But let's talk about innovation for a minute because this conference is really created around innovation. And we've already had a lot of conversation today about the perception that the speed of innovation is faster than it's ever been.
Absolutely.
And yet you have concerns about what our culture is doing to squash innovation.
Right, and fortunately in information technology, it hasn't been as intrusive. But as you all know, there are a lot of forces out there trying to move that in the same direction it has on pharmaceuticals and agriculture and so many other areas. And to me, this is frightening because I think if we had permissionless or open innovation, the growth rate in this country could be beyond what anybody believe, because that's the driver of improvement. People think, okay, it's capital. Well, if we just had more capital, go back to before we had automobiles and airplanes. We'd have more horse and buggies. Okay, that would slightly make people's lives better, but what really made it better is innovation, developing automobiles and airplanes. And if we had the same precautionary principles on getting innovations like that improved, particularly things that are as unsafe as airplanes and automobiles, there's no telling how long and how much money that would take. So that's what we're worried about, but our whole company is based on innovation, and I like to think one of our most powerful innovations was coming up with our management philosophy. And maybe some of our people disagree with that, which is great. But what we try to model our company around is philosopher science Polanyi called the Republic of Science. And that is where all the people working on the problem share knowledge. You try to bring the best the best answer. You challenge at every level. And so we have a number of mechanisms to do that. The first one is who we hire. We try to hire people who are open, who want challenge, who have humility. They don't have all the ideas that none of us know very much, no matter how smart or knowledgeable we think we are. And then to combine that with other people's knowledge. So if we're in a field, we try to constantly gather all the relevant information, not only in our fields, but other fields that could benefit us. And then we share knowledge internally. And we have, of our top people, top 25, we have something called the Discovery Board. We meet once a month, and every one of the participants, rotating, of course, brings up a problem or an opportunity, and the rest of us challenge it. And I love it. I bring up, okay, here's an idea of something we ought to do, and here's how I think we ought to do it. And the last one, I got 6 different attacks. I don't mean just,
they do that.
Oh, that is wrong. Oh, yeah.
And you don't fire them?
I love it. Are you kidding me? Because, I mean, there's people who don't want criticism of their ideas. What are they? Because their ego's too fragile? Well, how about if you implement it and you fail? Talk about a fragile ego at that point, your career is ruined. So if they can keep me from a disaster, I love it. And then we push those down, all the different groups in the company have something similar. And then we have something called Innovation University, where we put out materials to share innovations throughout the company and the principles of innovation. For example, as I said on experimentation, what we expect if somebody's running an experiment, to design it in a way that if it fails, you learn enough that you're glad you did it. It's like Edison said on inventing the light bulb. It had 3,000 or more failures. And a friend said, gosh, I'm so sorry you had all those failures. He said, I haven't had any failures. I've learned 3,000 things that don't work. And so that's our attitude. Now, if you don't design it properly, you don't really learn, and you don't attack the most critical problems first. If you kind of prove some marginal things, but the main potential problems you haven't dealt with, then that's waste. You need to start with the toughest problem first, and then try to disprove what you're doing. Because it's like when we used to do exploration, what I used to hope for was a clean, dry hole. If we weren't going to have a gusher, the next best thing is to have a clean, dry hole. Why do I say that? Because a worst one is you get, God, this is pretty good. Now we got to test another reservoir, maybe drill another well to prove it's commercial.
Fail fast.
Yeah, fail fast, absolutely. So that's what we... And this to me, and Karl Popper wrote a wonderful essay on this called Science as Falsification. That none of us, none of our hypotheses are very good. None of us know very much. So our obligation is to try to disprove it. And the author needs to try to disprove it and get challenges to make them think about what could go wrong. And then if you can overcome that, then you can have something you really can go with.
I've got a lot more questions, but I can tell already that there are a lot of questions out there. And I'll start right back here and then come up front.
Thank you, John Vane. My question is, do you believe in anthropogenic climate change? And given the risks of being wrong, don't you think it might make sense to err on the side of caution?
Oh, the precautionary principle at work here. Good. No, that's a great challenge. Yeah, I believe it's been warming, and I believe that the evidence is, I mean, there are such a thing as greenhouse gases, and they're contributing to that, but I don't think anybody knows how much. I don't think science is settled. I mean, how could it be? The people who are projected or who have these models, okay, if we do this, that, or the other, it could be increased by 1.5 degrees to 4.5 or 6. The ocean could rise 20 feet or 2 feet. I mean, so it is not settled. Matter of fact, science is never settled.
But you've been very outspoken about subsidies to renewable energy.
Oh, subsidies to everything. I think this is a big part of what's hurting this country is cronyism and corporate welfare. And this is
some of which you get.
Oh, yeah. No, we make a lot of money off of it as any established company because it's endemic in the economy. But what I object to is not studying. I think there ought to be more study. But rather than, it is not the scientific method to criticize and try to silence those who are challenging it. If we want to have more progress, we need to welcome, just as we do in our company, welcome challenges to this rather than name-calling and trying to shut them up.
Some people think your challenge has a little more clout than other people's because you can put a lot of money behind it.
Well, that would be good. I would hope so. I haven't seen it have a lot of clout, but I'm looking forward to that day.
Well, take that question here, and then can we bring a microphone right up here to the second row, please? Go ahead.
Hi, sir. Jason Rapp from Science Inc. A follow-up, I suppose, to this is that if you were spending a lot of money to influence policy, if you were put in charge of climate change policy, how would you approach that? How should a government which is supposed to look at economic externalities, public will overall, how should government approach that issue?
No, that's a great question. Thank you. No, I'd get rid of all the corporate welfare. I would not have the government picking winners and losers, particularly uneconomic solutions or products or systems that are making people's lives worse rather than better. They, even under all the models, they will make very little difference in the future on what the temperature or the weather will be. And instead, I would break back all the barriers to innovation and trying new things, new forms of energy, and let people be free. That's what's caused progress in the world, is free people, liberated people, are ingenious. Those people are trying to silence, enslave, overregulated or not. That's our future, and then that's win-win because we'll have better forms of energy that will deal with the problem. And what we have now are very inefficient systems that are making people's lives worse.
But there is a market problem here, right? If you believe that carbon is contributing to the warming of the earth, there is no cost on emitting carbon. No. And so there is no market incentive that takes that into account.
No, there is a market. There are a lot of people who believe in that, so you have pressure from your customers. I mean, we in our business with Walmart, we are constantly working on how to save on transportation.
Because your customer wants to.
Because your customer.
You think that's sufficient.
And we want to. And so we got into biofuels and making chemicals with biotechnology because we found that the basic biological or biotechnology was at a point that we could combine pieces and make chemicals out of CO2 and hydrogen cheaper than we can make them chemically. So we're doing that. No subsidies or anything, but we have a huge undertaking
based
on
pressure from customers.
Well, no, this is what many people want. So we're going to do it if we can do it economically, but we're not going to go seek subsidies or advocate subsidies for that because we think that's counterproductive.
Right here.
Michael Miller, Ziff Brothers and PC Magazine. You talked about innovation. One of the things that's been clear over the past little more than 10 years is that productivity numbers in every market across the world have gone down from what they were 10, 11, 12 years ago. How much of that do you blame on regulation, and are there other factors that you think are important?
Well, I think that's the biggest one. And that comes from my study of history, and the slogan I like best of countries was Holland in the 17th century, and it was "Listen, even to the other side," And so after they got freed from Spain, they reorganized the society to have absolute free trade, free speech, welcome dissidents from all over the world. And they had an explosion. They become the wealth, became the wealthiest country in the world through their innovations, and not only in economics, in art, in everything. And that's my dream, to move our country and every country that would toward that. And then this gets rid of the divide. The divide comes with the, if you control the political system, you do well, and the people who don't, you punish. And that's where we're headed, and we see that more and more, and that's where the world is headed. And so I'd like to see it go in the opposite direction, one of mutual benefit, where we work together and have people feel liberated so they take chances and innovate, which throughout history, that's what's raised productivity.
This is going to have to be the last question in the back.
Hey, Forrest Collier with emails. Question is, you've had an incredibly successful career with a wide range of manufacturing companies. Have you or are you interested in investing in any of the kind of technology companies that are here?
We have. We've invested in a number, and then we bought Molex, which is specialized in connectors. And just our philosophy on acquisitions is we want one hand to wash the other. That is, we will only buy a company if applying our core capabilities and our philosophy will greatly help them. And then if they have capabilities and businesses that can provide a new platform for us, growth for us. And that's what Molex has done. They're working with all our business groups to find how to make all our products and processes smarter. We don't have time to go into that. And then we've expanded their vision to not just make connectors, but make systems and apply economic thinking more thoroughly to everything they're doing.
So if these people have companies they want to sell to you, they should meet you in the green room after this.
Yeah, well, or send me an email.
Charles Koch, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Alan. Appreciate it.